discriminate, and to discriminate only generates hate. And when you hate, then you're bound to get irate. Yeah, madness is what you demonstrate, and that's exactly how anger works and operates. Man, you gotta have love just to set it straight. Take control of your mind and meditate. Let your soul gravitate to the love, y'all.
People
y'all.
Killing, people dying, children hurting, and crying. When you practice what you preach, and what you turn the other cheek. Father, 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 help us. Need some guidance from above. These people got me questioning.
Always new change, new days are strange. Is the world insane? If love and peace is so strong, why are the pieces of love that don't belong? Nations dropping bombs, chemical gases filling lungs of little ones with ongoing suffering. As the youth are young, so ask yourself, is the loving really gone? So I could ask myself, really what is going wrong in this world that we living in? People keep on giving in, making wrong decisions, only visions of them dividends. Not respecting each other. Deny thy brother. A war's going on, but the reason's undercover. The truth is kept secret, it's swept under the rug. If you never know truth, then you never know love. What's the love, y'all? Come on,
I don't know.
What's the truth, y'all? Come on,
I don't know.
What's the love, y'all?
People killing, people dying, children hurting, and crying. Can you practice what you preach? What you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us.
The weight of the world on my shoulder. As I'm getting older, your people get colder. Most of us only care about money making. Selfishness got us following the wrong direction. Wrong information always shown by the media. Negative images is the main criteria. Infecting the young minds faster than bacteria. Kids wanna act like what they see in the cinema. Whatever happened to the values of humanity? Whatever happened to the fairness and equality? Instead of spreading love, we're spreading animosity. Lack of understanding leading us away from unity. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling under. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling down. It's no wonder why sometimes I'm feeling under. Gotta keep my faith alive, love is found. Ask yourself,
where is the love? Where is the love? Where is the love? Father,
Father, help us.
Send some guidance from above.
These
people got me questioning. Where is the love?
Sing with me, y'all.
One more, one more.
We only got
one more, one more.
That's all we got.
One more, one more.
There's something wrong with it, yeah. Something's wrong with it,
yeah.
Something's wrong with the good world, world, yeah. We only got
one more, one more.
That's all we got.
One more.
Welcome everyone to Ramona Speaks, The Other Truth. And I got to figure out why there's no sound. If y'all say there's no sound.
We have, let's see. We have Catherine Yronwode today. And we are. We have sound. And we're going to be discussing long distance healing, shamanism, auras. And I want to welcome my guest, Catherine.
Hi.
Yronwode.
It's nice to be here. I always enjoy being on your show. And I had a wonderful time when you were on my show.
Oh, well, thank you. So, what are we talking about, Catherine?
Well, I thought today, kind of been thinking about this, and I brought the topic to you, and you agreed that we should talk about it. We've been all through this, more than a year of lockdown, people not going to doctors, people not going to the dentist, people not going for their checkups, people's health in question. Now that things are beginning to loosen up, people are still reluctant to go out. They're reluctant to, get out and go to a doctor, go to a hospital. What if that hospital contains a, illness that they don't want to expose to? Meanwhile, we've been finding a lot during this last year and a half that people are turning to the, what I would call the old school, old fashioned, old ways of healing with herbs and roots, with plant foods, with the idea of healthy food mixed for a healthy body. And what I've been finding is we talked somewhat about herbal healing the last time, but we did not cover distance healing. So distance healing is a form of spiritual work. Now, of course, the American Medical Association will be right about now going, that doesn't exist. So we'll just set them to one side. They're entitled to their opinion. American Medical Association, you go over there and sit down. All right, now, the rest of us are going to talk about distance healing. So there have been for centuries, for generations, forms of distance healing. The oldest form is prayer. That is, Lord, heal her, right? That's distance healing. You are not giving a medication. You are not doing a physical manipulation. You are not necessarily even in the presence of the person, although you might be. But how many times a young woman has prayed for a soldier overseas and say, heard he was wounded, got the news he was in the hospital and prays for him, but never goes to that distant land to see him in the hospital. So prayers can be distance healing if they are prayers of healing. But there are other ways of focusing healing specifically for use at a distance. And that's what I wanted to talk about today. And I know, Ramona, you know what I'm talking about.
Oh yeah, I do. I do have an experience with that.
Of course you do. That's the wonderful thing. That's the wonderful thing about you and me. We know many of the same things. And sometimes just dialoguing between the two of us brings these topics out for people who don't know, new to the subject, newly adult, just finding out what's available out there in the world, trying to reinvent the wheel. So I like you to talk what your experience.
I'll tell you my experience. This had been around about 1984. And my granddaddy had to go into the hospital because there was problems with his veins, and he had to have a toe amputated because he wasn't moving around a lot. He was losing his sight. Well, around 2 o'clock in the morning, I'm living in Oakland. My parents are in Hayward. My granddad is in the hospital at Herrick Memorial. Mm-hmm. And my mom says, okay. Now, me and my granddaddy were like two peas in a pod hooked to each other. She says, well, I don't want you to get upset, but the hospital just called and we have to go there as fast as we can because they said your granddaddy is not going to make it. And you don't need to go because there's no point. I just wanted to let you know. And I said, okay, and hung up the phone. And right away, I went into my, I don't know what you call it. Some people call it astral projecting, prayer, whatever. And mm-hmm. What I did was I went to my grandfather from my bed into his room. And I talked to him. And this is after praying that, to God, that if it's his time, okay. But let me talk to him. And I told my grandfather, I said, Daddy, if you are tired and you want to leave, go ahead. I understand. But don't give up if you feel that you are a burden, because I will always take care of you. You know, you're never a burden, and I want you here. But I understand if you are ready to go, but don't go because you've given up and you think you're a problem to us, because you're not. And then I put my astral hands on him and I caressed his face and I said, whatever it is, I want you to rest and be at peace, but hold on and stay here with me just a little bit longer if you want. And then I zoomed back into my body, right? And I'm sure there was a lot of time that passed, because as soon as I zoomed back in my body and time enough for my parents to get from Hayward to Herrick, it was about 35 miles. My mom, the phone rings, I answer. And my mom says, the doctors say they don't know what happened, but all of a sudden his blood pressure started rising. And it looks like he's gonna be okay for now. And I said, all right. She said, there's no need for you to come because he's stable. And then I said, all right, I know what I need to do. And the next day, because he was in intensive care and you could only stay there 10 minutes on the hour, I was there for 2 days. I slept in the room, and those 10 minutes on the hour, I was in his room praying for him, talking to him. And my dad, my granddaddy lived about 15 more years after that.
Wow.
So I know.
You know, that's the, and I knew you knew. Now, I'm going to interview you about this for, no, listen, I'm going to interview you about this for the young person who just heard all of that and went, wow, how could I do that? What is that? First thing is definition of terms. First thing is always to know what a word means. Astral travel. You just said a term that is very dear to my heart, astral travel. Astral travel for many purposes. They're not just for healing. So astral travel is a form
astral of travel.
Spirit traveling through through time or through space or both, right? In this case, you traveled through space, but left the time just the way it was. And astral travel is to take your spirit and literally, as you said, it went out of your body. And then later when you were done, you had your astral hands while you were there. You were there in astral form and then zoom back into your body. Now, I'm going to tell you what I know about astral travel. I believe that because, again, you and I came up same area, same teacher, same world there, that what I know about astral travel is going to be almost identical to yours, because I followed you 100% when you said that.
Yeah.
But again, somebody listening to this show will not know what we're talking about. So I'm going to go back, because I'm a historian, to a man named William Walker Atkinson. Now, William Walker Atkinson was a lawyer in Philadelphia in the 19th century. And he went to the Chicago World's Fair in 1892, which was called the World's Columbia Exposition. And they had teachers and cultural figures from all around the world. It was supposed to be a big exhibition of people of the world. And he met and was exposed to some Indian Hindu practitioners. And this was a white man. He was a lawyer. He just saw these people and he kind of had this moment when he realized that these Hindu teachers knew things that he had not learned in his church. And he decided to study what they did. He didn't ever go to India. He just stayed in America and read books, but he began to write about these things. And when I was young, the books of William Walker Atkinson were the best guide I had to astral travel, other than studying with a woman, and she lived in Berkeley, and her name was Leah Minda Andandian, which was obviously a not her birth name, Leominda Andandian, and she had studied the works of William Walker Atkinson, and she taught me and a bunch of little baby hippies like me back down in the 60s. Mm-hmm. Well, what William Walker Atkinson did, he wrote under a number of names, and I hope these we'll get these all in the links here. He used names like Theron Q. Dumont. He wrote under the name of Swami Panchadasi. He wrote under the name Bhakti Vashita. These were Hindu names he took on. The reason he wrote under so many names was that he was a very fast writer. This man was just, he could just write, and he'd write, and he'd publish these books. He had his own publishing company in Chicago. Eventually, he moved to California, and that is one reason why you and I, even though we may not always uplift his name, we teach according to his principles, because he taught in California from early 1900s up until his death, and he educated an entire generation of healers on the West Coast. And so William Walker Atkinson, I always uphold his name, because I never would be where I am without him. And the way you described everything you described, that's William Walker Atkinson's technique. Oh. So I'm gonna tell you how I learned it from Leominda. And this again is for the young. I know you know it, but this is for the young,
yeah,
or the people from another culture just drifting around. They find this and they go, what's she talking about? He didn't want to bring a lot of religion into it. He used these Asian names and other French names and all these different names to talk about these things. As I said, partly as a way to explain that he was publishing so many books. People wouldn't believe a man wrote that many books in one year. So we'll leave aside that performance that he did under these names. We'll just call him William Walker Atkinson. His technique was sometimes called the astral travel technique, or sometimes called the silver cord technique. And in this, he had many ways of describing it. They're different in different books. But basically, as you said, you go into that astral travel space inside yourself. That is the hardest thing to explain. You have to kind of withdraw yourself. You can sit with your eyes closed, sit quietly. You withdraw yourself from the periphery of your nervous system. You kind of pull yourself in. If you could imagine yourself like a shellfish with an exoskeleton, and you just kind of pull yourself in, and then you come out of yourself and expand again. And so now mm-hmm. you're outside yourself. Is that not right?
Yeah.
Is that not right? And he explained it as often being of a silvery appearance. And I always experienced it that way. A sort of a silvery, moonlight looking myself. Now, he said in one of his books, and the way Leominda Andandian taught me was, if you know what a cicada is, otherwise known as a 17-year locust or 13-year locust, it's a little insect. They come up, they pupate, they come up out of the ground, they split open on the back, and coming out of that split on the back, the entire cicada comes out, unfolds its wings. And we've all seen butterflies do that too. Right. And he said, that's what you're going to do. You're going to come out of the back of the base of your skull or the back on your spine, out of your heart chakra if you want to heal, out of your head chakra if you want to have a more a mental spiritual effect. You're going to come out that way. And he also said, if you pay attention, keep a silver cord connected, like an umbilical cord, like imagine an astronaut in outer space in that silver little spacesuit with that umbilical cord, don't lose your body. He always said that, don't lose your body, because not good to lose your body and never be able to come back. Now that does not mean it's dangerous. It just means check in on your body. You don't want your body falling off the chair and getting hurt while you're gone, right? So have your body in a safe place. I was taught by Leominda that you can light a candle if you have trouble going into the astral state. Obviously you did not. Light a little candle, can be just a tea light, a little birthday candle. It just doesn't have to be something that's burned a long time. Just light that candle. And interestingly enough, if you light a small candle, it'll burn for 20 minutes. You'll come back by when that's time for that candle to go out. Another part of your mind is keeping you timed on that candle if you want to use a candle. Okay, you go out, you go up, and you just said, you just went from where you were to Herrick Memorial Hospital, and you went down into his room. And then you began to talk to him. You come in talking. That's how Atkinson described it. That's how Leah Minda taught me. You come in talking first, right? You don't make a move. Is that right?
Right.
Right. Because you don't want to wake them up and you don't want to scare them. You want to talk to them. Hi, Daddy, it's me. I'm here. You know, I'm here. I'm here to help. And then you give them the message and you give them the message. And then you can do healing with your hands. And I have done healing the lightest touch. And you can also dialogue with them. But often if they're in a state where they're not quite fully awake, or they're not quite fully conscious, or they're not quite fully alive, as you might say, they're drifting, you don't need to say to them, talk to me, like on some, you know, EMT or some television drama. You just talk to them from your heart, and then you can give them the lightest touch. And if they indicate where they have something wrong, like I did one for a woman called me, her son had been in a car accident. And so I went to him, and I was talking, and I knew he would live. That was not the problem. But he kept on with his own, now this is kind of get to another level, with his own astral hands, he was pointing to his own astral left wrist and trying to hold his left wrist. Well, what had happened was his hand had been mangled, and he wasn't sure if they were going to be able to fix his hand. They were just trying to stabilize his vital signs. They were going to operate on his hand later, right? But he was like all about the hand, my hand, something's wrong with my hand. And I put my hand, astral hand, over his hand, and I said, don't worry about your hand. We've got your hand. And I got him to take his own right astral hand off of his own left astral hand. I said, we've got your hand. We're going to keep your hand here. We're going to fix your hand. Don't worry about your hand. Just take some slow breaths and be in your body now. And he calmed down. And as she said, that's exactly what happened. He'd been scrabbling with his, they had actually had restrained him because he kept on scrabbling, trying to get to his hand. All of a sudden, he just went calm and he realized we had his hand. It was okay. Now, when you're done with that, and by the way, I can't say I healed his hands. It was his doctors in the surgery that healed his hand, not me. But we got him to accept that his hand was going to be healed. Mm. What happens then? You come back, and zooming back is a good way to describe it. You could just pull out and whoop. It's like some people describe it as a reeling in that umbilical cord or going down a tunnel or whoop, you're right back. And I often find myself rocking back a little bit as I come back in. Do you do that? You know what I mean?
No, I just snap back and then snap back. Open my eyes.
That's right. Well, that's the next thing. I find myself, I kind of almost like, it's just like my head goes back and go back just a tiny bit. And then I open my eyes and I then have to take a moment.
Yeah.
I'm here. Make sure my astral body is in my body. I'm back in my body, and then all is well. And then thank God for the privilege of being allowed to heal somebody.
Yeah.
So that's my way of doing it.
Yeah. And it's weird because, like, at that time, I had, you know, read a little bit about astral projection, but every time I would try to do it just to see if I could do it. When I didn't, I would start out meditating, slowing my breath, you know, getting to that state, because I wanted to feel what it was like to rise up out of this body. And it's funny, and what the first couple attempts, it's like I started smelling things. You know, I mean, there would be a smell, and later on when I researched to find out what, you know, you're traveling through different levels, I guess, or dimensions. And, you know, at first it would just smell, you know, and would start to distract me, and you can't be distracted. And so I'd snap back, Then I try again. And, you know, I start to lift. I could feel certain parts of me lifting and separating. And then I'd get that smell again and I'd freak out and zoom back.
Yeah.
Because I didn't know it was like a sulfury, stinky smell. I could never get beyond that point at first. And I didn't have anybody to talk me through it or, you know, teach me or anything. It was all, you know, what you read, because I read a lot. Mm-hmm. And then finally, when that happened with my grandfather, I just went there.
You that's because of there was a need. And so you broke through levels of what normally would have been training. I'm going to step back a little bit here. Astral travel isn't only done for healing. Astral travel can be done to say hello. Astral travel. Yeah. The one of the first people who taught me about astral travel who came out of the Black Oakland Hoodoo tradition told me, well, you can go do that to somebody you love that they have you haven't seen them in a while and go to their house. And the way she said it was say, Johnny, this is so-and-so. Now don't wake up. First thing you have to say is don't wake up because they'll wake up right away. Don't wake up. I'd like to see you. And I'd like to just run into you naturally. You don't have to phone me, but I want you to have this is a nice dream of me. And you don't have to get all sexy. People are like, oh, get all sexy with him. No, no, you don't have to do that. You just say, I mean, you could, but you don't have to. Right. Just say, I'd like, when you wake up, just remember that you dreamed about me. And I'm going to be going down shopping, and I'm going to be down on Broadway. And I'd like you to come down on Broadway. Let's just run into each other. And you can say that, she said, and they would.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I tried it. I didn't have success with everybody. Doesn't always work. But I had enough success that I could tell, even as when I was starting it, whether the person would resist me or whether they would do it, you know. And I would say, telephone me. I want you to, when you wake up, just phone me. Just phone me. Say, you know, you had a dream about me. You don't need to remember the dream. Just phone me. They'd phone me.
Yeah. Yeah. What's the difference between that and bilocation?
Well,
explain that to everybody.
That's a very good thing. Bilocation is a person who is operating in a conscious level at two places. And astral travel, you tend to be a bit vacant where you really are while you're doing it. Bilocation, it is a form of bilocation, but you have reduced consciousness where your body is, and you've put your consciousness with your where your spirit is. Bilocation, I would think you could do both. That's my take on it.
Yeah, it's like, now I can't tell you how, but I know that I was told I was in one place.
Right.
And people talked to me.
Right.
And yet I had never left home.
Right. Well, that is okay. Now we're getting into where they perceive you. See, we started this with talking about astral travel for healing, and the person was unconscious or semi-conscious in the ICU.
Right.
However, many people in hospital will report, yes, she came, you came and visited me, didn't you? Right?
Yeah.
But you didn't. That they really saw your spirit, but they saw your spirit as fully embodied. And there are, I've had that happen to me too. People say, usually when there's great need, and they say, you know, I was going down the road and I hit a patch of black ice and the car started to spin. And all of a sudden, my father was there giving me driving lessons, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the father wasn't there. I mean, but the father was there giving them driving lessons and saying, no, don't turn into it. Don't turn out.
Wow.
They got through it safely.
Yeah.
And then they called their daddy up and they go, the father would, you know, Jesus. And he goes, I knew something was wrong. I just had that little moment. I thought, I hope he's okay. But they did not. They were seen, but they did not say, I'm going there, but they were seen there. So that's a form of bilocation also.
Wow.
Now, distance healing has a reputation, and I'm going to be real honest here. I'm going to cut this in a moment here. Distance healing has a reputation that is word of mouth. Those who have experienced it, feel it, know it. There are people who are good at doing it. Very often it is a family thing. People do it for their family members and their loved ones. There are people who say, I will do distance healing for anyone for a money fee. Be cautious, because there is no proof in hand. And you know when it worked, when you did it. And these are stories that we know and tell. But if someone is on the internet, or, you know, in the old tabloid newspapers of when I was young, saying, I will do distance healing, be very cautious. You don't know that they are doing it, and you don't know that they can. And I'm not saying that everyone who claims to do it is a fraud, by no means. But I'm saying, learn to do it yourself. It's a God-given gift. And most of us can do it when push comes to shove and when need arises. But there are going to be some people in your family who will be better at it than others.
Yeah.
Just like there are better cooks in your family than other people, and there are better gardeners in your family than others. Almost every family that has survived over the ages has some thread of this gift and skill in their family to heal and guard and ward somebody at a distance. It's one of those human things. Now, you can go to people and ask them to pray. And I'm going to then take this to a step of prayer. You know, people go to church, and the church is saying, we're all going to pray for the healing of Miss So-and-so, right? That is a form of distance healing. Now, of those people in church who pray, probably 10% of them just, you know, wish church was out already. And the other... Yeah. The next 10% said, well, I never liked her anyway, right?
Yeah.
and the other 80% are really putting their heart into it. So church prayer, it can be very effective. It can be very effective. But among those in the church who pray, some are more effective at it than others because they have that gift to be able to do it. And I think
that what helps them do it is they are able to pray in their spirit.
That's right. That's right.
It's a different, I mean, you know, with the spirit that they really left, you know, have not even aware of their body.
That's right.
They are communing.
That's right.
And I think that's the difference.
Right. Now, this William Walker Atkinson, whom I mentioned, he was a friend of and connected with a man named Claude Alexander Conlon. And Claude Alexander Conlon was a farm boy from the Midwest, and he'd gone to the Yukon to go prospecting for gold and whatever during the big gold rush in the Yukon. And then he got involved in, this is so crazy, he got involved in... I guess you could call it a gang of card sharps. They would cheat people at cards. Mm-hmm. And he learned how to manipulate cards. Well, when there was a big shootout, lots of things happened, he left. And he decided that his skill at manipulating cards would be better served doing something a little bit less risky. Mm-hmm. So he became a stage magician, and he performed at little theaters all up and down the West Coast, Seattle and all the way down to Sebastopol, California, and in Oregon, Portland, and so forth. And he was a stage magician, but he also was a spiritualist, and he became friends with William Walker Atkinson and a proponent of the New Thought movement. And he began to write books, and it may be that Atkinson helped him write, but he started something around 1919 called the Crystal Silence League. He used a crystal ball to read for people. Eventually, in fact, rather soon, he was the highest paid stage magician, you know, like a David Copperfield, disappearing right. people and doing all that stuff. He quit. He quit it all in 1925, moved to Los Angeles, and became a healer and reader for the rest of his life until the 1950s, and he never went on stage again. He gave away all his secrets of how he built all of the contraptions that made the stage magic work, and he started the Crystal Silence League. So what that was he felt that if people would pray for the healing of others at certain times of the day, as the world turns, there'd always be somebody praying. So he asked people, get up in the morning at sunrise, because he was a farm boy. He always got up at sunrise when where he came from. You get up at dawn and you turn your face to the east and you pray for all of those who are in need. And then at noon, you take your noon break, and he knew exact noon, and turn to the south where the sun is the highest in the sky, and you pray for everyone for the sustainment. So all new things you pray for first, any kind of new desire that anyone might have that would be good. Then at noon, you pray for the sustainment of their lives. And then if the sun sinks in the west, you turn to the west and you say, pass it along. I pray for everything that must come to an end. Just as this day's work has come to an end and some lives come to an end, I pray for all things that are ending. And he did that every day for the rest of his life for the good of humanity. He put out little postcards and he'd say, what do you want me to pray for you for? And there are photographs of these bags of mail that came in a Los Angeles post, a big old canvas bags of these postcards, and of him sitting there leaning on them going, every day he would pray on these bags of postcards. And he'd read them out loud to himself to get himself in the right mood. And he would send people a message, you know, Jenny in Sioux Falls, you know, I know that that boy will love you. I know he will. God has willed it. If it can be, it will be. Have faith, have heart. It's all right. And he'd pray each one of those things. He'd pray morning, noon, and night.
Wow.
In the Bible. Now, the Crystal Silence League disappeared. He published little books on it and everything. He also sold William Walker Atkinson's books. He was in L.A., and William Walker Atkinson had moved to Santa Monica by that time. And Atkinson died first. He was a much older man. And then Conlon passed away. Well, I found one of Conlon's little booklets in a bookstore in Santa Rosa, California. And I was just intrigued by it, and I began to research, and I found there was nothing much known about it. So I reprinted the book because I knew it was out of copyright, and I restarted the Crystal Silence League. And I did that because I felt this man had given so much, and there was so much there. In the end, my husband, Nagashiva Yronwode, and I funded the beginning of the Crystal Silence League online. And so you can go there. It's crystalsilenceleague.org, O-R-G. And you can pray. Now, what we did was to make it into a more modern thing. You can post your prayer, and then other people will come along and pray for you. And that is for anything. Not just for distance healing, but for to get that job you need so badly, to find that love, you know, to find the missing relative that you need to find, anything it is, you can ask for it in prayer. What we learned, we've been doing this for years now at the Crystal Silence League. What we learned is a lot of people don't even know how to pray. They only know how to make a demand. You know, they don't even know how to even ask God. They just say, I command that so-and-so pay that money he owes me. That's not a prayer, folks. That's a command, which is different. It's a magical command. But Crystal Silence League is for prayer, and there are many, many prayers for healing. We also have links there where you can go and get connected with things like, you know, different, for instance, if you're praying for a pet, there's different pet finder and different places where you can find pets, and ASPCA, where you can contribute money. If you have a problem with mental illness in the family, there are places you can, you know, hotlines you can call. Right. We have all of that there at the Crystal Silence League that's practical. Yeah. The idea is to teach people how to pray for one another.
Right.
Because that's what Claude Alexander Conlon did. We then put out, I found a second book of his and a third. I found many, many of his little pamphlets that he had put out over the years. and with my friend Deacon Millett of Four Altars Gospel Sanctuary in Joshua Tree, California, we put together a book of his collected work called Secrets of the Crystal Silence League. And it has a picture of him in his stage costume, where he's all dressed up with a turban and feathers and stuff. Aww. Much younger. He's so cute. I just love him because he was so cute. And we illustrated it with pictures of him on stage, including floating his wife and all. I mean, he did all these, you know, he did these stage tricks, but he was really an honest man. And he always separated the stage tricks from the spirituality. So we talked about his life a little bit. But the book, Secrets of the Crystal Silence League, talks about how to do these things to help others. It gives people who may not know the words to say. You and I speak very naturally, but there are people who freeze up. And so he gave words that you might say. They would be what now we would call affirmations. They're affirmation pages of them, you know, affirmations for health, affirmations for wealth, affirmations for love. And he wrote these out and he called these codes, because the word affirmations was not a word that he used. He called them codes, as if it was, he said it was like telegraphing, you know, you just clickety click, click, click on the old telegraph and the message comes through and the person uncodes it in their mind. So these words were very compact, and then you would have that joy, you would have that healing, you would have that prosperity that you had asked for. Right. And he would send codes to you, and he would also teach you how to receive. See, we talked about a passive person who was in a hospital.
Right.
But if someone knows that you are sending, then they need to learn how to receive.
Receive it.
Right. And that brings us to the subject of Reiki. Right? Because Reiki is a Japanese version of the same thing. I guess you could, I mean, it's so similar that it's just, you know, Reiki is the universal spiritual energy. You can send Reiki energy to somebody. And, but very often in a Reiki session, the Reiki practitioner asks you to be receptive. Have you ever had that done to you by a Reiki practitioner? Or do you do it?
No, I've never had it done. But, you know, without knowing that it was Reiki, I used to work that way with animals.
Yes. All right. Well, I had a good friend. She's passed now. Her name was Rukaya Shaman. She was lived in Ohio. She was a member of AIR, the Association of Independent Spiritual independent readers and root workers, and I belong to as well. She was a Reiki practitioner. She was African-American and Cherokee. And she had studied Reiki from Japan, from under Japanese practitioners, because she found it effective. She did a Reiki session on me, and it was very interesting because it was like astral travel, but it was just this little bit different. She said, I want you to sit in a chair. She said, I want you to put your 2 feet on the ground. Don't twist your legs up. And I said, how do you know I twist my legs up? She goes, I can feel you twisting your legs up just by the way you talk. And we had no visual communication. It was just by telephone. She said, I want you to put your feet on the floor. And I want you to put your hands just quietly on your knees or on your thighs. And I want you to sit up, but not too straight. Just sit relaxed in your chair. And she goes, now turn your hands over, palms up. And I'm going to fill your palms with light. And I, whoa, my palms filled with light. She goes, can you feel it? I said, yeah. She goes, okay, we're in contact. And then she did a whole scan of my body. She diagnosed things that I knew were wrong with me that I never told anybody, ever. She knew exactly what was going on in my body. She did, filled me with Reiki energy, or what I perceived of as golden light, which is often used for healing. And she was very present. I mean, it was very present. With my eyes closed, I could see her face very dimly, but I could feel her hands on me. But she wasn't touching me. It was like what some people call an aura massage. She was like just that little bit off where your hairs just tingle. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I could feel my hairs would just rise up as she would go over my body. She was spreading her hands on the back of my back with her thumbs toward my spine and her fingers outstretched. And she just went down my spine and then back up, cupping with the base of her hands. I could feel it. She got up to the top of my head. She went up over my head. She got over my head. She said, "Something with your right eye." And I said, "Yes." She goes, "You have migraine." I said, "Yes, I have chronic migraine." She goes, "All right." She goes, "Let's put some extra energy into there." She did that. She was amazing. She's, like, wow. I said, she's passed now. She was a teacher, a healer, a great, great woman. But she did this, and again, not a fraud, not, you know, I mean, she did this over right. the internet. You know what I mean? She was
the real deal.
Real deal. But she taught me techniques, partly by using mommy, and partly we sat on the phone, we discussed this, and she taught me some techniques. She also used Reiki on clients in person. They'd lie down on a little, you know, like a massage table. She did therapeutic massage. She had started with therapeutic massage, physical therapeutic massage for people with injuries. And then she just got into Reiki. She saw that it was putting a lot of energy into people. If you were to go to the readersandrootworkers.org website, there's a spot in there you'd have to find. It's called In Memoriam, and there's a picture of her, and because she was a member of our group for a long time, and we kept her web page up as In Memoriam for her. But there's a picture of her with a bunch of feather fans on the wall, and she did something which on the West Coast we called feather massage. She did not call it feather massage, but we called it that on the West Coast. And it comes out of Native American birdwind fanning. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
You move the air over somebody?
Yes.
This is related to hoodoo, to African American folk magic practices, where you will brush somebody with a buzzard wing or a black hen wing. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
And but you're not necessarily touching them. You might.
Right.
But you're not. It's just you're moving energy around, I guess, right. That's what you call it. She right. did that too. And but she didn't have to have you there. She had a very large doll. Now this was she had sewn it herself, I believe. It was a doll about the size of a large baby or a small child. It was sewn out of cloth, brown skin, like she was, with clothes on it, all just, it was like a doll.
Yeah.
And she used this as, she called it her healing doll. She would, if she couldn't have the person and she couldn't get in touch with them astrally, because sometimes she felt there was resistance, she would put that doll out on, it was on a little cloth bed. She'd light four candles, two at the head, two at the feet. Four candles would be lit. And she'd say, "Now, whatever I do to this doll will be done to this person." And she would do her healing on the doll. If she could not find that person in the astral realm, or if they did not let her come.
Wow.
And there's a picture of that at our site too.
Oh, yeah, that's almost like tea, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Just moving that energy, transforming it into what you need it to be. That's very interesting.
Well, that is a form of what she called it, shamanic healing. She called herself Rukaya Shaman. She had legally changed her name to Shaman to show that she was a shaman. And she had learned a lot, as she put it, she was part Cherokee and part African-American. And during that time period, the white Cherokees, as we might call them, had ejected black Cherokees from the Cherokee tribe. I don't know if you know all about that or heard about it. It's pretty shameful.
Yeah.
And she was talking about this at a big powwow with an Ojibwe native person from Canada. And he said, "Well, if the Cherokees won't have you, we will." It's very obviously her native. So she went over to become an adopted Ojibwe. And she was she would refer to herself as a Black Indian. That's what how she called herself.
Yeah. Yeah. Because if you go back through history, you'll find that a lot of those on the East Coast, closest to Africa, were the what they call Native Americans, were really Africans who had come over from Africa long, long time ago, long before European settlers landed here.
That's right. That's right. And, well, that's what she, that's how she identified herself. And she said, if the Cherokees won't have me, the Ojibwe's will. That was good. But she used a lot of what I would call East Coast and Upper Midwest style Native American healing practices, which are distance healing. Again, different than Reiki, different than the Hindu methods that William Walker Atkinson had learned. And yet all of these methods go back in time, back to ancient Africa. These are all old, old methods of healing at a distance.
Yes. Yeah. It's, you know, I have a question. What do you think about, because like, because everyone cannot do it.
Mm-hmm.
And there are some that are so natural at it.
That's
even
right.
without training. So do you believe that ancestrally, from wherever this gift comes from, that it is passed down ancestrally?
Yes, I do. I do. And I kind of alluded to that. I said almost every family has somebody in the family who has done, can do this. And I believe if they didn't, that family wouldn't have survived. Yeah. In other words, it is a life-affirming, life-changing, life-preserving gift. We could say a gift of God. We could say a gift of nature that that runs through families. It is not only found in women. It is found in men. Mm-hmm. It can be even found in the littlest child.
Yes.
I have read stories of that where a child would run up to mommy and say, mommy, mommy, you know, Uncle Bob, the tractor turned over, but I'm helping him. You're like, what? But it was true, you know? And the child goes, you got to go find Uncle Bob because I can only hold him so long. Whoa, it's a little child said that. These stories are passed on in families. They are true stories. And those people who nobody trained that child.
Exactly.
That child heard the message and responded. And we are connected in ways we do not always know.
Exactly. Because as a child, in animals, it got so that the kids, even as I grew up into my teens and stuff, would always call me the animal girl because there was this connection I had with them. I knew when they were sick, and strays sick would find their way to me. And I would just, touch them, rub my hands over them and find where that pain was and do whatever it was that I did, you know, to help them, you know. And it just got in my neighborhood. That's what I became known as, the animal girl, the animal lady, as I grew older, you know? I mean, they would come from all around. It was weird.
I have that gift too. And often I have found in talking to people, our colleagues, people our age, who are professionally engaged in the mystical work, many of us were the local weird kid who could heal animals, or that animals came to for healing. Yeah. We were broadcasting on a wavelength that those animals could hear. Now, I'm going to flip the script. Wow. There are animals who can do this too.
Yes.
There are animals who know when their owner has been hurt. There are animals who will cry out. And you say, what are you crying out for? They know that was when the car accident happened. And, you know, so-and-so was injured or dead. But animals are so innocent. They don't conceal it, and they don't fear it, and they don't hide it for fear of being thought weird. I mean, who says, oh, my cat's too weird, I don't like my cat anymore? But a little girl like you, little girl like me, they said, oh, you're a witch, right?
Yep.
They did, right?
Yep.
Right. You're a yep. witch. Well, but they never said that to the cat. Well, maybe they might. But the cat doesn't care. The cat doesn't care. Cats are innocent. Dogs are innocent. Dogs are amazing at this. But even smaller animals, even a bunny rabbit, there are, I know it sounds, you know, after a while you start saying, what? Yeah. But there are tales of animals, small animals, who know and also know to heal other animals.
Yeah.
YouTube is now, back in the day, these things were passed along as little stories. You know, oh, well, my cat brought home this little injured chipmunk and nursed it back to health instead of killing it. What?
Right.
You know,
right.
But now on YouTube, we see it happens. And now we're sharing these stories about the compassion of animals and the healing qualities of animals. The cat that knows you're feeling bad, or the dog, they know it, and they come to send their spirit to you. But also, you can send your spirit to help an animal, just the same. It's, we're all on a level here. In other words, this is a, when you said ancestral, this is ancestral, even pre-human. I believe this interconnection, what we call the web of life, exists all over. I mean, if you think of outer space, it's just like all of this life, right?
Right.
And it's all connected.
Connected to that ultimate cosmic.
Yeah. That's right.
Where are our little silver threads are connected.
That's right. Where our little silver threads go. That's right. Now, what Claude Alexander Conlon did, he went by the name Alexander. What he did was he said, let's not just wait for need. Don't wait for just for someone to send me a postcard and I'm going to pray for that. Let's just pray. Right? Let's just send it out 3 times a day. We're going to send out whatever blessings, healings, help, and encouragement we can to everyone. And he asked for people to do that. I think the more you use it, the better you get at it.
Oh, yeah.
What do you think? You think it, I mean.
I do. Now, I want to ask you this. Do you think that certain things in your life that might dim your light, your connection?
Yes.
Want me to name them? Please.
The first dimmer is alcohol. The first dimmer is alcohol. It somehow, you get all fuzzed up, you can't do it, and you can't receive either.
Okay.
There are other dimmers. I'm going to go, you know, there are heavy drugs. I mean, I could go down the list of dangerous drugs, and I will say there are dangerous drugs that will cause it to be blotted out. You'll start to shut down. And among these are some drugs that tempt you. You think you're expressing it, but you don't. So my feeling is the worst drugs are alcohol, methamphetamines, and cocaine. As far as dimming these things, the opioids don't dim it so fast, because they do help people go into a reverie. And they've been used that way historically to put you in that reverie. If you're not naturally gifted to go into the astral, well, a little bit of some whatever will kind of put you there. And marijuana falls right on that line. Cannabis falls right on that line. Cannabis has been used to put people into the astral for ever,
and peyote,
for it's one of its real purposes. That and poppies, I said, you know, not the kind of, I'm not talking about fentanyl, I'm talking about just actual poppy, just a little bit of poppy. But cannabis will put you in that zone very quickly, and it can be used as a training tool. However, overindulgence will end up dulling you to the real world, and you spend all your time in the astral, right? You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And there are gifted people, they become less and less inhabitors of their body, and they have spent more time in the astral. It's so pretty there. Well, all right. But they cannot function. They may be able to really give you a message, but they may not be able to go shopping, you know, with you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
But I do believe that cannabis has a role to play and has always had a role to play. It's an ancient herbal ally, but use it wisely and carefully.
Yeah.
It's like a cup of coffee. A cup of coffee tends to take you away from the astral. It speeds you up. Once your vibration gets a little speeded up, you're not going to take that time to go in and slow your breath. You don't want to speed it up. So that's
what about LSD? Because
LSD.
I've had an experience with that. I guess this was in the 70s, and it was purely by accident.
Mm-hmm.
And man, it took even the my friend was a famous psychologist, and I had to call her because I was experiencing some things, but I just told her, look, get me in a dark room. And I was able to just drive over there, but everything started changing. You know, people look like cardboard cartoons. The car I was driving like a little cardboard Volkswagen. And she put me in the room. I said, now just leave me. I'll keep the kids out or whatever. And I had an experience and I had to talk. The psychiatrist couldn't understand how I was able to do it. Mm-hmm. I had to keep telling myself it's only the acid, because what I was seeing, I mean, like in the 2001 Space Odyssey, you know how it went down, you know, he changed all those different ages and then went down to that baby and floated out into the universe and connected on. I went there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I hear you.
And finally, you know, 18 hours later, I was back to normal. That's when they thought, how did you do it? How did you? Because I had to do it myself. But I experienced some things and I realized how easy it was for people to totally flip out on that.
Right. Right. Well, again, this goes back to a theory about natural herbal allies, which we've talked about before, and white pills, right? Or liquid injectables, liquid drops. The ingredients in LSD, of course, are refined from things that occur in nature. Peyote. Right. Peyote has been used in healing ceremonies forever.
Forever.
And there's a ritual to it. There are other things of that type. You know, the California Indians used Datura, which has belladonna, which is a different kind of drug, but it also very strong drug. But they were used in ways that were, there was an ordeal and a ritual connected with it that kept you from flipping out. You know, in other words, it was training that went into it. The LSD and the other ones that go with it, you know, magic mushrooms, those are milder. Right. And those don't hurt people as much. I flipped out on LSD also. But I also had some very good learning sessions with peyote and with, especially with the psilocybin mushrooms. But the LSD, after a while, it was like a roller coaster ride to, you didn't know where you were going to get off. You know what I mean? Somewhere. So it has a bit of confusion built into it.
Right. Because
I would not recommend LSD to people who want to develop their astral travel. You'll travel, but you're going to be on a loop to loop and you don't know if it's safe or not. You know, it can be a,
you have to have a strong ego,
you have to have some reason
or something, because you have to constantly let yourself know that you are seeing and experiencing, but it is not real.
Right. That's right.
And that's the hard part, because
you're Yeah, that's what I used to say. It's like you're going, just remember, you got on a roller coaster, you're in an amusement park, right? That mean whatever you see, whatever you do, it is in that amusement park. Right. But on the other hand, with psilocybin mushrooms, I found I was actually able to read people's minds. I was able to function somewhat. Mm-hmm. And I saw things that were, psilocybin was more interesting. Rather than traveling through space, I traveled through time.
Yeah.
And I remember going around Chicago on the loop and going down to Maxwell Street, and there was a man selling peanuts. And I could just, I was like slipping back and forth. I could see the buildings being built. I could see them being repainted, the signage on them, layers of signs, the different, I mean, it was like, I was like living in about, 70 or 80 decades, just sort of slipping back and forth. It messed with my time, but it was kind of pleasing. I felt like I connected to that place very deeply, but I was not able to travel in space like I am with cannabis.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? It's different. They're all of these. And remember, I only recommend it. I'm going to, you know, because people are going, oh my God, can't get stoned. I'm only going to recommend using herbal allies. I do not recommend white pills. I do not recommend injectables.
Chemicals.
I do not recommend liquids. Laboratory drugs, I do not recommend.
That's the key. That's the key. And have you noticed that on any enhancers, have you ever seen illness manifest, like come to a physical form that you can actually see it?
Yes.
And pinpoint it.
Oh, yes. Have you? I can tell you asked the question. So you have, right?
Yeah.
Tell me about it. When did you see that?
I was dealing with me, actually. And I had gone to, I was having issues with endometriosis when I was 17.
Oh.
And I had another cyst growing. I mean, I knew because my body tells me when something is not right.
Right.
And so you go to the doctor, sometimes they look at you like, you know, when you go in there letting them know what's wrong with you, they tend to look at you sideways. But I had a good doctor, Dr. Cangelo in Berkeley. And I told him, I said, I think there's something wrong. I think there's something growing inside my body. So he gave me an examination. And sure enough, he says, oh my God, he said, you have some cysts. I can feel them. You know, the size of a grapefruit. I want to take them out. And I said, give me a month. And then we'll see. And he said, okay. So I went home and I changed my diet and I went into a meditation. And somehow I was able to go inside my body. I pinpointed where it was. It appeared outside my body. And it was like this gray gut kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what I worked on, and I kept, you know, like putting the light on it, shrinking it. At least I was hoping that's what I was doing. So mm-hmm. in 30 days, because it never appeared again. And so at the end of the 30 days, I went back and he looked up in there and he threw the thing up. He says, oh my God, he says it's gone.
Wow. Wow.
But nice. It did. It appeared, you know, like I could see it out of my body in this icky, grayish, gunky thing with hair and teeth and all kinds of things in it, you know?
Wow. And so I'm going to ask you a question. So what you did really was bilocate and astrally heal yourself.
I don't know. I didn't know if it would work, but I said I've got to try something because I didn't want a hysterectomy. I didn't want to be cut on anymore, you know. Yeah. And it just it shocked him. He says, "What did you do?" He says it's gone. It went from a grapefruit to gone.
Right. Wow.
But
yeah.
But can I do that? Not always. I just always know. It's like my body tells me.
Yeah.
But trying to convert, and because I have gone through things that have diminished my vision, I try to explain it to the doctors and I tell them there's something wrong, there's something wrong, there's something wrong, there's something wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I know my body.
Right.
And it's like it cries out to me.
Well, I'm going to bring up another aspect of this, which we have not yet touched on before. You are doing what I call a check-in. You checked in with your body. You looked inside your body. I know a few ways to do this. One way I was taught, this is, remember I mentioned that woman, Leah Minda Andandia.
Yeah.
She was a wonderful teacher. She said that in addition to astral traveling to heal others or to communicate with others, we should communicate with our own organs. Mm-hmm. And she said, now all your organs, she said, you can almost think of them as like little creatures of that have their own reason for existing. You know, your liver, your heart, your lungs. There's no reason. We're very arbitrary. The shape we are, the way we developed, evolution, it's all very, it's what worked, but it's kind of a hodgepodge. Your lungs may not know how important they are to your toes. You know, your toes are just saying, get me some fresh blood, you know, and the lungs are, I'm oxygenating as fast as I can, you know. And this goes back also, people like William Walker Atkinson and back to Phineas Quimby and the New Thought movement and the idea of self-healing by checking in with your body and doing what's called a body inventory. Wow. So you sit there quietly and you just start with whatever place you like to start. Some people start with their toes, some with their hands, some with their heart and move outward. Some go through the chakras upward. Whatever it is that you've got a pattern, go through the pattern. Some people just go, is there any pain among all my parts? And you go to the pain first. Everybody has a different way of doing it. Some people put on their little hard hat and their little pickaxe and they go, I'm going down into the mines and I'm gonna check every vein in my body. Whatever it is you do, there's different ways to do it and different people advocate different ways, but however you're going to do it, you're going to visualize the check-in and you're going to go through all those parts of your body. And often those parts of your body feel neglected. They're not hurting. They're just feeling a little off. Touch them physically with your hands. That's the best way you can show that you really, and look at them if you can with your eyes and say, I see you. I feel you, I heal you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, in your case, this was internal to you. So you externalized it, right?
Yeah.
And then you got rid of it. So that's another way to work, is to externalize, but there's also a way of actually going inside yourself and just doing it inside. I had a friend who had cancer and he had an operation to take out this large tumor, but they said there was a 50% chance of it growing back and he didn't want it to grow back. So he did an exercise every morning. He'd lie in his bed on his back and he would just take his astral hands and reach in. He knew where the scar was. He knew where the tumor had been. And he'd just go around in there and just massage it internally, saying no tumor growth, no tumor growth. One day he said, uh-oh. He felt this little thing about the size of the end of his little finger, the last strand of his little finger. He said, oh no, it's growing. And he just grabbed it with his hand. He twisted it off, like he said, like twisting a grape off of. He took it out, came out of his body. He had it in his hand. He said, get the out of my mm-hmm. body. And he threw it. Now, this is an invisible thing. He mm-hmm. threw it and it went away. And he said he then washed his hands and it never came back. Now, what would the doctor say? Oh, he had an imagination. But I believe he was right. I believe he, and it did never come back. But he felt it the moment that it started to come back. And he got rid of it in the astral and it disappeared in the physical.
Yeah.
Now, those are anecdotal stories. Remember I said the AMA is off to one side, let them do their thing.
Yeah.
But don't discount this because it is real. It does
this
happen.
This is personal experience. And
that's right.
And I think they also know, because they're starting to, not in the same language, but they are starting to tell people, you know, to relax, that distress, you know, de-stress, you know, think positive. They're not using the language that they should be to make it more clear to people, but they know, because they have seen cases where people have cured themselves. And
that's right.
Without any of their medical explanation for it. So they know there's something to that. But just like everything in this society, it is about the almighty dollar.
That's right.
But so now what I think insurance companies are doing you know, like now they're providing pre-screenings before sickness, I don't know what to call it, but they're trying to get you to a point where you are so healthy that you avoid getting sick by doing certain things.
That's good. That's good.
Yes.
I mean, that's
because they
that's
know.
Well, yeah. That's true. But, you know, like I said, I don't have any fight with them. I don't have any fight with them at all.
No.
But I'm just saying there are things that have happened that I've seen happen that don't necessarily follow along with the medical textbooks. That's all I'm
exactly.
going to say. But
exactly.
having said that, I'm going to say there are things, don't hold to the foolish belief that you do not need a doctor, that
For
you
real.
Can cure everything. Remember, everybody dies anyway.
That's
but
right.
you want to have at least a good and gentle death if you can. But
yeah.
but so stay healthy. But if your doctor says to you, I want you to lose 50 pounds and eat different, do what your doctor says. And if your
yeah.
doctor says this one cannot, whatever this thing is, you're going to need, you know, some sort of medication. If you ask your body, do I need this medication? And then now I'm going to go to another level here. Ask your astral doctor, do I need this medication? So who is your astral doctor? In the spiritualist movement, there is a very strong belief. Oh, you know, that most people believe we have a guardian angel. But the spiritualists have believed for a long time that we also have other spiritual beings. These could be ancestors, and they could be just helpful people who have passed into spirit. Spirit doctors, spirit teachers. And I'm going to give you an example of a spirit teacher so you know what I'm talking about. A person who grew up poor, never learned how to read or write, and wanted to learn how to read or write, and wanted to become an educated person. But there was no school available to them. And they said, I'm going to sit down and ask the greatest teachers of all time to teach me. I'm going to ask Pythagoras and Socrates to come teach me. And they received teaching from these spirit teachers. And they did learn how to read and write, and they did learn how to be an educated person. So these things happen. Spirit doctors are often, they're not the same as a spirit guide who carries messages. Spirit doctor may come to you if you say, I call on the astral plane, you know, you're going to sit in meditation. I call for a doctor, a consultation with a spirit doctor. Might be some little 19th century Jewish guy from Germany. It might be a Native American guy from the 1500s. You don't know who you're going to get. It's going to be a spiritual doctor. I need a bone setter. I need someone who knows about cancer. I need someone who just simply needs to know about fertility. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And up comes this woman who's been a midwife all her life, and her spirit appears before you. And you ask questions. Do I need this surgery that has been recommended? You're consulting with this spirit doctor. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And then you say to that spirit doctor, you can say, is there anything that my doctor has overlooked and that I should be doing that this has actually happened to me. The spirit midwife lady said, peppermint is always good. Peppermint tea. Okay, thank you. So you get these little clues and cues from a spirit doctor. These spirit doctors, to me, are available on the spirit plane. They are spirits who have passed on, who have for whatever reason of compassion or interest, make themselves available. Now, you may not be able to find them, but a spiritual healer may be able to find them for you. In other words, a spiritual medium. A medium is a person who communicates between a person and the spirit world on their behalf. The medium might say, I am in contact with a spirit doctor who says, yes, your doctors are doing right, or no, ask your doctors to do this and that and the other.
Right.
But if you have the gift, try to contact a spirit doctor yourself. You will be surprised. And also call in your ancestors. For instance, in my family, there are certain illnesses that run in my family. Among them, diabetes and heart disease. And so if I call in my ancestors and I say, I wish to honor you, but I do not wish to follow you down that path of diabetes, right? Mm-hmm. What should I do? What would you have done different? And they'll tell me right off, and I've followed their advice. Don't gain weight. Just don't gain weight. And stay away from so much sugar. And, you know, it's, I laugh because, of course, they fell prey to it. So we all come from somewhere. We all have connections somewhere. But there are other beings who are here to help. Great doctors of the past may be able to be available to us.
And seeing this all boils down to one, taking care of yourself spiritually, mentally, and physically.
That's right.
Take the best care.
That's right.
Keep your bodies as pure as possible in this day and age of chemicals all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
But healthy. Honor your body. And if you honor it, get to know it, talk to it, it will tell you things.
That's right.
It's about being in tune. We are in tuned beings. If you shut out the noise, you can hear so much and see so much. You know, just learn to still your minds. You know, listen to you. To your spirit, get in touch with it, because all of this will make sense if you don't know about it. And you can try it if you've never experienced it.
That's right. I find it's kind of complicated to talk about it while not doing it, but in order to get the word out, you have to talk about it. But in order to experience it, you have to sit down and do it.
Yeah. And two, like, we're from the old school, you know, pretty soon we won't be here.
Mm-hmm.
And we're trying to pass on knowledge, advice to those coming up now.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And the, you know, it's not a new age thing.
No.
Because what we're talking about is ancient. And, you know, everybody wants to jump on the wagon.
Mm-hmm.
With a That's little right. bit of a knowledge, a little bit of this, and, you know, go out there. But you can tell the difference between your interviews here and the things you say and how it's free flowing, because it's coming from a place of true knowledge than someone who has a site up. And I'm not disparaging anybody, but it's just so people can, you know, discern. You know that they're reading from a book. They're not yeah. necessarily speaking from experience. And if you don't have the experience, you don't really, I wouldn't go to a doctor who's just coming on his first day on the job.
Mm-hmm.
I just wouldn't. And well, that's the thing with people, you know, that you are letting inside of your bodies.
That's right. That's right. There's a lot of ego involved. And there's a lot of what I call bad acting. And what I mean by bad acting is if they had been hired to act on a TV show, they would be reading their lines wrong. And these people have YouTube channels and they claim knowledge and all that. I'm not putting anyone down. I'm just saying right. I've seen it. I've also seen really sincere, really good YouTube channels. So just be aware of, get the vibe of what the person is up to. Yeah. Another thing I recommend, and again, I'm just an old book dealer's daughter, you know, so I have a bibliography online. My husband and I have a little nonprofit foundation we have called the Yronwode Institution for the Preservation and Popularization of Indigenous Ethnomagicology. And the initial letters spell out the word Yippie. So Yippie is a place where we put up information for people about what we call indigenous ethnomagicology. Ethnomagicology meaning not the magic that came down from hierarchs, but comes from the people. It's like ethnomusicology, ethnomagicology. And indigenous means it is regional. It belongs to the people of each culture and each tribe and each village. It's indigenous. And it is not brought down to them from hierarchical systems. So in that Yippie website, which is yronwode.org, which is my last name, Shiva's last name, yronwode.org, yronwode.org. When you go there, it'll say Yippie. And there's bibliographies. Now, why do we do this? We take topics and we put up book lists of older books that are not hype. These are books mm-hmm. that are information that people put online. So we have one called the New Thought Bibliography. So this is about a part of what we were talking about today. New Thought involves healing. It also involves prosperity and there's other things. Many people know New Thought now through the ideas like The Secret, and so forth. But New Thought is not the same as New Age. They're different.
Mm-hmm.
Just the word new is the only thing they have in common. We also have bibliographies on divination systems like numerology and, on just you name it. We've got bibliographies on how to use spirit boards, Ouija boards. We have a whole bibliography of books about Ouija boards and books about pretty much, pendulum dowsing, anything like that you want to know about. We've got bibliographies about them. Those books are older books. Many times you can find them for free. They're out of copyright and you can find them online. We're not hosting the books. We're just hosting the lists of the books' names for those who want to explore this more deeply. So you can also, if you are interested in spiritual healing, there are teachers nowadays who teach you. But again, I'm going to recommend that you start with an inventory of yourself and then also try to contact somebody. So an inventory of yourself is to see if you can do medical diagnosis through spiritual means, and trying to contact somebody else is to see if you can do distance contact. You put them together and you can come up with distance healing, which is what you did spontaneously on, no one even taught you, just bang, there you went, right. Because there was a need. But if someone wants to learn this in a way where they're not waiting for a need to just jump out at them, you want to start with trying astral travel and then try astral healing, try astral self-diagnosis, internal. And I'm going to leave you with one other idea. This is a West Coast thing. I asked my husband if he'd ever heard of it. And he said no. And he's from the West Coast. He's from San Jose. So maybe it's just a Bay Area thing. I don't know, North Bay. Have you ever heard of aura fluffing? No.
Where they work is
where they fluff your aura. Where you sit in a chair and they fluff your aura. Yeah, you just did it. Yeah, you know. See, I mean, back in the day, you'd go to these psychic fairs and there'd be a person with a chair and it would say, aura fluffing, $5. And a regular chakra alignment, $25. And I never had the 25. And I'd say, okay, fluff my aura. And they did exactly like what you said. They'd fluff, you'd sit there, they'd put you in a relaxed position, they'd give you some induction to breathe and so forth, and they'd fluff your aura. And you could feel it. They were not touching you. You could feel it. And your hairs would rise on your body, and you'd be fluffed and puffed. And it was like having your hair brushed, but in your aura. It felt good. It was like a light massage of your aura. Well, tell people
what auras are.
Oh, aura. I'm sorry. You're right. We didn't start with the
W. No, we haven't. We haven't done.
I got you. The aura is a concept of the fact that your energy field exists beyond your skin. Mm-hmm. So the aura is your, it's kind of like your awareness of yourself and other beings' awareness of you that extends outside of you. So one of the easy ways to test if you can perceive your own aura is put your left arm up if you're right-handed and look at it. Take your hand and your right hand and move it down towards your arm, and you'll start to feel resistance at some point off of your skin. You'll go, I just hit my aura. You'll feel it. You'll see it. You might not see it like a color. You'll go, whoop, that's where it is. That's my aura. Well, you can do it with your eyes closed. Oh, there it is. Mm-hmm. And that's the really interesting thing. When you start doing it with your eyes, you go, oh, my aura, I can feel it. And you can just take a whole assessment. You can feel exactly where it is. Now, what it is, it's your aura. That's it.
I call it like your life force that is bleeding through your skin.
That's right. You know? That's right. And another way, the hard scientists who hate the word aura, they'll say, well, it's your proprioceptive senses, which means your sense of yourself. Okay, well, that's just another way of saying aura. So now in a healthy person, the aura can be fairly large. And the weaker a person gets, generally speaking, their own self-perceived aura gets closer and closer to their skin. But another person can perceive your aura. In other words, they can, if a person has that sight, that gift, when you sit in the chair, they'll feel the edge of your aura and you'll feel them coming in on it. You'll feel, they're right there at the edge. They fluff and puff. They do it with your fingers, just like what you did. Do that again. That's exactly, that's it, right? And you can feel it where it is. And it feels really good to have someone run their fingers through your aura and fluff it. I can't explain it, but it does. It's like a little wake-up call to where your edges are.
Yeah.
So that's your aura. Now, one of the fraudulent things that I always warn people about, there is a scam that is used. When I was young, they would do it. They still do it. You can find people on YouTube doing it. They'll come to you and they'll say, I'm going to read your aura. And then they do read your aura. And then they make a scowly face and they look very menacing. And they say, there's a dark hole in your aura.
Mm.
And they can cure that for a $40 candle. Watch out. Beware. There are people who will say, it's like a doctor all of a sudden giving you you got a hole in your aura, but there's a dark hole in your aura. And often they'll say, there's a dark hole in your aura over your left shoulder. Why do they say that? Because most people, 90% of people are right-handed. So 90% of people, their aura over their left shoulder is a little weaker and thinner than over their right shoulder. And they notice if you're right-handed, they'll say, there's a dark hole in your aura over your left shoulder. And if you then are in there, you go, yeah, you're right. I can't feel my aura over my left shoulder as much. It's true. Most people cannot. Now that can be remedied. You can have someone working on expanding your aura until you do have that. And you can also do it internally by going in and saying, I wish to pay attention to, correct any deficiencies in, support and encourage my left shoulder. And then you do that for about 15 minutes. And you can hear your left shoulder. Mine has often said to me, almost tearfully, oh, you noticed, right? Because my left shoulder just isn't as flexible as my right. And I give it to them. My left foot too, same thing. Wow. So those frauds know that they're going to hit 90% of people who are right-handed have a deficiency in their auric energy field on the left side. So be aware of that. Don't fall for the fraudulent people. They're just betting that that's going to be right, the right answer to you, but it's wrong of them to do it. So yeah. Take care of it yourself. You can take your right hand and say, I'm going to give my left shoulder a little bit of a puff and fluff. You can do that yourself. And you can also speak to your different fingers and say to yourself, I'd like to, my head chakra, I'm giving my head chakra a little bit of a fluff, but it really works when someone else does it to you.
Yeah. Yeah. And also too, for people who have a hard time imagining what an aura is, I don't know. Tell me if you agree, because like you're more learned than I am. But as a child, even I could see the aura on anything that had been living or is living. Yes. And yes. I can't see the colors. I always see the light, the halo. I call them the halos.
Yes.
Around them.
Yes.
This even is furniture.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. And you are a very gifted person. So let's talk about colors of auras for a moment. Many people, I wouldn't say many, but I have known many people who see aura color and mm-hmm. interpret it in various ways. Certain colors are healthy, certain are not. I tend, like you, to not see much color. Sometimes I have seen color, but yeah. I'm not a big color aura seer. I see light, a halo. And yes, I can see it around anything that was living. This is for one reason. I surround myself with wooden furniture.
Right.
And I'm going to explain it. I'm going to let the cat out of the bag here for a moment. I was born with very low vision. And the reason I don't show myself on YouTube or anything like that is that I'm cross-eyed. My eyes they wander. I don't see well. I close my eyes a lot of the time because I just don't see. Don't see well enough even to get a driver's license. Okay, so that's just me. I've been like that all my life. It cannot be fixed. I was born with it. Okay, and it runs in my family, by the way. So I found that I would be bumping into things, right? I hurt myself as a kid. I'd bump into things, but I didn't bump into wooden furniture because the wooden furniture warned me that it was there.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you could feel it.
I could feel it, but metal furniture, I'd bump right into it.
Yeah.
So
because it's not living.
I've never told this to anybody. I believe that wooden furniture communicates with me through the life spirit that is still left of those trees in a friendly way. Wooden furniture doesn't want me to hurt myself. Wooden furniture is, yes, this is just their bones. That's all that's left is their bones, but their spirit is still there in this wood furniture. And I'm going to even go one farther. I have experimented with many forms of wooden furniture. And then when I was young, mahogany and walnut were like big high class furniture, and oak was kind of poor people's furniture.
Right.
Oak. I'm looking right now. Oak bookcase, oak bookcase, oak bookcase, oak desk. I got my keyboard that's on oak. Now I have gotten to like teak. Teak is okay. I get good vibes off of teak, but really my whole life has been spent around oak, and I don't know why. It's like it speaks to me. It is alive still in spirit, and it will not allow me to run into it and smash my face.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. True. That's absolutely true.
Yeah. So, I mean, the world is just just amazing.
It is amazing. It's amazing.
You know,
saying things like that, you know, people gonna say, well, not only is she a witch, but she's crazy as a loon. But I'm not crazy. That's true. That's true.
You know, each person's experience, this is not anything anybody's telling me, you know, to believe. I speak from experience.
Right. That's right.
And then I find others have the same experience.
That's right.
And perhaps it's something that, you know, one has to say, okay, I want to see. Mm-hmm. It's easy. You will experience something if you open your mind. And it's, you know, I would love to meet an Aboriginal person.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know they have some experience, just ancestral. You know, anybody who can communicate over 1,000 miles mentally has a tribe. I want to learn something from.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I should
before it's destroyed and pressed down and oppressed. Because Earth people have a connection. We are connected, and that connection can be broken or bent. Like any kind of communication, that static, whatever, from just the stuff that we're inundated with, you know, and mm-hmm. and what is natural to us has a life form, like animals.
That's right. Well,
you have to hold on to it.
Yeah, and we do need to hold on to it. And one of the things I always conclude these talks with you, you and I both always seem to get back to nature. Walk out in nature, take a look. Nature is where it's really at. Don't just stay in the concrete caves. There's a lot more out there, folks. And do your best to get out there and, you know.
Even in today, you know, just go out on your porch, in your yard, and start being quiet and just listen, even in the city.
That's right. That's right. I believe and hope that people will somehow understand that we've gone down a bad path with this overpopulation in these concrete boxes. We're just raising a bunch of confined laboratory animals in little boxes. They're losing their connection to each other. They're losing their connection to the world. And it will not long endure. It cannot long endure. So wherever you are, whatever background you came from, whatever socioeconomic class you come from, find a little patch of green. It doesn't have to be a lawn. It could just be a little walk in the city park or something, and connect with birds, connect with trees, connect with leaves, connect with plants. They're there, and you will be able to feel them. And you know, try to reach out. Don't just live in the little world of human beings and their flashy clothes made of petroleum byproducts. A lot more out there. Right. All right. Well, I'm started preaching now. We better shut me up.
Oh no. But it's true.
I know once I start preaching
that across to people, because we are nature.
Yeah, that's right.
We're an extension of nature. From the little smallest insect to the highest bird, to man, to the fish. We're all one. We are all connected. What affects one is a ripple effect. You just don't know it.
That's right.
And don't let, you know, this lockdown, take advantage of it to connect to it, to calm yourself in all of this. Because we don't know how much longer we're going to have the benefits of being able to go out there and breathe air, you know, feel clean water, you know, dig in the earth before, you know, if nothing changes, it all becomes polluted.
That's right.
Before we're driven underground. Yep. Or we become half human, half robot.
That's right.
Enjoy the light.
Enjoy it. That's right. Well, I always enjoy talking to you, hon. And I'm gonna say we've talked for a long time. I hope people had an interest in it. I'm going to invite you back on my show again. And people loved you when you came on my show. And I'm just going to give a little shout out to Lucky Mojo.
Yeah, go right ahead.
Hoodoo Root Work Hour. We do readings for people. Ramona is a very good reader and psychic reader. And we will bring some topics to our show, but then we also do free readings for people. So if you ever wanted to have a free psychic reading, you can sign up at the Lucky Mojo Forum, which is forum.luckymojo.com, and you can get a sign up sheet there, and then if you're chosen, you'll have a free psychic reading done for you. We've been doing these on podcasts since 2004, and we're not stopping anytime soon.
Wow.
Sign up.
And let them know
every Sunday.
They can get herbs and books.
Oh, yes.
And everything. To tell them the Lucky Mojo site.
Yeah, luckymojo.com. We are a spiritual supply store, a metaphysical supply store, a cult bookshop, and we publish books on folk magic of all kinds, specifically focused on indigenous ethnomagicology, and of that, African-American hoodoo, conjure, and root work is our special topic of interest that we publish books about.
There you have it. There you have it. And once again, Cat Yronwode, thank you so very much for joining me and having the Cat and Ramona show our once a month meetup.
It's nice
to discuss things. I like to call it all natural.
That's right.
Natural healing, natural living, natural loving.
That's right.
You know, just in awe of this planet that we live on and all the things that are available to us to help us. And with that, I'm going to say thank you to the listeners for tuning in. This has been Ramona Speaks, The Other Truth, with guest Catherine Yronwode of the Lucky Mojo organization, because it is an empire. And I shall see you Saturday on Ramona Speaks The Other Truth. And my guest will be part two with Valkyrie Ice McGill. And we will be talking about technology, robots, and the sex industry and how robotics are a part of that now. And till Saturday, God bless and take care.
All right. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.